I compare and make the results public. Now, discuss the results of three surveys. There's a survey already done at the United States. That's already conducted since 2002 on online education. And it involves more than 2,000 U.S. institutions nowadays. At the start not, but nowadays it has more than 2,000 U.S. institutions. Nothing was happening in Europe. We didn't have any survey on online education of open education. We couldn't benchmark ourselves. So therefore, the AUA, European University Association, did have a survey in the end of 2013 on e-learning and MOOCs. And that's a new survey. They did have a response of almost 250 institutions. And it was published in, I think it was November last year. But I will talk about that. And then is the home survey, one of the projects on MOOCs, who did a survey on MOOCs. But I will discuss this, these three.
As you're speaking, I'm basically adding the links to the website with the reports and the surveys. So if anybody wants to check.
Yeah, they are on the slides as well, but yeah. You can Google them, etc. Just on this one, this is the latest US survey. And the link is there on this side. They have a regular report and can also make a comparison with, for example, fall 2003 to fall 2013 about the growth rate in the number of students taking at least one online or distance course. So then in their definition, in the early, it was only related to content. So it's not about online master, online bachelor. It's about an online course where more than 80% is delivered as content online. And you see an increase, almost 35%, but still an increase in 2013, but not as large as it used to be. But the number of students in total, both private and non-private, is still more than 5 million and increasing. They predicted last year, and I don't know in the last survey, they predicted that in 2017 or 2018 there will be more students having an online course than students in a face-to-face setting doing a course. But that was based on a growth rate, I think, on this one in 8 or 7%. So we are approaching in the United States where there are as many students taking online course as a face-to-face course. And therefore the growth rate is also decreasing. So then this is a question on online education is critical to the long-term strategy of my institution. And the blue line you see in the United States, it was less than 50%. And nowadays it's more than 70% agrees that online education has to be part of the long-term strategy of the institution. So you cannot deny it. Yes, 30% is still denying it, but 70% does it. And is online education also represented in the strategic plan of 2014? So 70% is saying in 2014 it should be. And we are not there. For private, for profit, it's 80% already who has in plan, not in plan. So that's in plan is more than less than 60. So you see that a lot of institutions want that in a strategic plan online education should be part, but it's not always there. And then about awareness on open educational resources and Creative Commons. I didn't mention Creative Commons. Creative Commons is a kind of licensing that gives the people the right to remix, redistribute the material. So this is a picture about the faculty awareness and academic leader awareness. And you see that the faculty there is not aware about what open educational resources and Creative Commons is. Who did know about Creative Commons? Was anyone? Yes, one, two, only two, three? Creative Commons. Who did know about Creative Commons? Yeah. So yeah, perhaps there's some similarity with the United States as well there. Then the second survey was published in November by the AOA. Here's the link at the bottom. This is the complete title. This is the picture of the report. And they have a question. Does your institution offer any of the following online courses, online degree programs? So not only courses, online degree programs, blended degree programs, or joint online learning programs, etc. So you see that out of their 250 institutions who responded, 82% is offering online courses. Blended courses even more, but surprisingly, it also has online degree programs, is already 39%. So what I'm mentioning is not a course, it's an online program is already offered. And even, and that's also why I'm saying it's not about only the perception of the added value for the learners. When you have opening up your material, you can have also joint degrees and joint online programs. And it's already 40% is offering some kind of joint program. So that's in Europe now. So. And what kind of IT systems are we using in Europe? And you see that we have a lot of online access to libraries, access to computer rooms, Wi-Fi. Okay, that's very standard. Email accounts, licenses to software, online study catalog. And then it becomes less. So I think these things are already common. Every university already offers this. But that's not an online degree. It's not an online course. There are facilities for that. And I think 24% is offering online examinations. I think it's very high. I was surprised. I think it was 5% or something like that. It's already 24% is already offering online examination. So when we're talking about later today about quality, it's not about quality of libraries and access, but it's also quality of portfolio and examinations. Because these are more standardized quality aspects, and these are more to the learning aspects. When you look at the quality aspect, then the AOA study has two questions. Is there an internal quality assurance consideration with e-learning? And is there an external quality system? So only 29% has a quality system on e-learning. And an external quality assurance is only in 23%. Out of the 250 institutions who responded. So you can read the comments in the report itself. I only want to demonstrate there is a strategic issue of including online education in your strategic plan of the institutions. In Europe, a lot of things is happening on online education, but we need to work on the quality assurance. So institutional e-learning policies, you did have the United States figure where who said 80% of 70% we should have a plan, and there's only 50% who has a plan. In Europe, it's also 50% has a strategic plan on online education e-learning. But it's under development, so it will be increased the coming years. What are the objectives for e-learning? And again, the most things are related to effectiveness and flexibility. Flexibility of learning, like I said, for also flexibility of higher education system and need for jobs, is the flexibility aspect. And to increase effectiveness in the classroom, more learning opportunities on campus, where not on campus, etc. So those are the four related to online education. The last survey I want to talk about is from my own project on MOOCs, and then it's about institutional MOOC strategies in Europe. It was published last week, so it's fresh on the results now. You can find the link on edu.au there. You can have the report itself. what we did is we did take the questions from the United States in those survey, and we repeated some questions for the European institutions. So you see, there is the US survey 2013, US survey 2014, and our home survey in Europe in 2014. So it's published 2015, but it was in the last quarter of 2014. The main difference, has MOOC offering is much more in Europe than in the United States. In Europe, we are very much more active in MOOCs than the United States. More and more institutions in Europe are offering MOOCs. Even is planning to add a MOOC, if you count those two. More than 70% is already having a MOOC or planning to have a MOOC. In the United States, it has decreased in planning. So the hype is over in America, in the United States. And in Europe, it's not a hype anymore, 70%. It's becoming mainstream. In the AOA study, so from the European Association, was in 2013, they said 85% of European institutions is having a MOOC or is planning a MOOC. In our survey now, 1 year later, it's 71.7%. So it's consistent. In America, it has decreased from 14.3 to 13.3. So this kind of large difference between the United States and America, I cannot explain. Perhaps it's biased by the number of institutions replied to both my survey and the AOA survey. But it's a large difference. About the bias, we did have almost all institutions of Portugal replied in our survey. And so it's covering one country. We're making one country report now, and it has the same results as this one. So I cannot say it's biased, because in Portugal all the institutions are involved in the survey. It's a large difference between the States and Europe.
I'm sorry, can you tell a bit about the sample of institutions that answered the question?
Yeah, that was in the beginning, United States.
I simply can't believe that numbers in both of surveys. 71% having a MOOC?
Yeah, it's about...
A MOOC with your definition that you use.
What is the definition? No, it's about the question is the same question as in America, and that was the question, states of MOOC offering,
okay,
and the, and those
is the MOOC
it's not defined. And not in the United States and not in the, so we, it's about what's the common perception of the MOOC.
Okay, then maybe
yeah.
Otherwise 70%. I'm sorry, I can't believe that.
No, so numbers. Now if you look at then you say Portugal. In Portugal, they have 13 institutions, higher education systems. 12 responded in our survey.
But
12, so it's Portugal. Then I say, Portugal, I make a country report, and then in Portugal, 68% is having a MOOC or planning to have a MOOC within a short notice. So then I say, why bias in Portugal is representative to this study?
Why this skepticism?
Yeah.
Why
are
we
saying
that?
Because according to the definition that you gave us,
yeah.
I don't think it's possible. Bearing in mind what were the numbers a few years ago, that they would be able to develop courses and even degree programs in that percentage.
No, most of them only have one or two MOOCs.
Yeah.
So it's not about complete program, it's one or two MOOCs. And
I wonder if they... Count online or open education in that category. Maybe.
Now, if you look at the number of MOOCs now offered in Europe, it's more than 1,000. So, if it's one MOOC per institution, it's 1,000 institutions.
Yeah, but we have 4,000 institutions. In
yeah,
Europe.
So that's 25%. But who's planning? 70. No, 70 is per having a MOOC or planning to have a MOOC. Yeah, so that's those two together. And I think that the AOA study already confirmed that they said it was already 58%. And it's more than 50% of their institutions replied to them. And then you can say, okay, it's biased because the sample is biased. But those last difference. And even my example of Portugal, where all the higher education institutions replied to our survey. So I think there will be a bias, but that cannot explain those last differences. For compensating to the bias, we make a distinction between institutions offering a MOOC and all the institutions, just to say what the difference is, if you already have a MOOC or not. This is also a question used in the United States. Are credentials given to MOOCs, will that give confusion to higher education? So not only a certificate of completion, but a real credits to a MOOC. In the United States, it was only said in 2013, more than half agree on that it will give confusion. In our survey, most of them disagree with the statement. And that can be true because of we have the ECTS system and we have a quality assurance system that people are not afraid that credentials to MOOCs will have a disruptive effect or make confusion to higher education. In the United States, there is the perception that it will have. Again, a large difference between the States and Europe. This is also a large difference between the States and Europe, is the importance of to learn about online pedagogy. So the pedagogical and didactical approach of courses. Again, a large majority in Europe agrees that it's important. In the United States, it's not that important. Another difference is that MOOCs are seen as a sustainable method, not a method, but sustainable methods of offering courses. In Europe, most agree. In the United States, most of them disagree, and the number of institutions disagreeing is increasing. Then there's another question repeated in both surveys. How well are MOOCs meeting the objectives of an institution? Again, in Europe, most of them saying it will meet most or some of the objectives of the institutions.
Yeah, but they must be part of objectives first, right?
Yeah, so they have to define objectives. And sometimes institutions say we have to be on the train because everyone is on the train and then we have MOOCs. But then we ask about what are the primary objectives, why an institution is involved in MOOCs. And again, it's the US, both US surveys and the home survey in Europe. There are a lot of similarities. Primary objective to have and generate income, learning about scalability, exploring cost, supplement on-campus situation are not that important. The most important issue is to increase the visibility of the institution, so its marketing and reputation. In the United States is to drive student recruitment, and in Europe it's more about flexible learning opportunities, and those flexible learning opportunities are most important for institutions not involved yet in MOOC. So they have the perception that it will have a flexibility opportunity. Well, institutions who have a MOOC, it's like the similar to the United States. Then if you look at a cluster of objectives and we asked what are the relevance of different objectives, then you see that the financial reasons are not that important. Most important are, again, reputation, visibility, the innovation area, and to the demands of learners and society. So based on those surveys I presented, we can say that European associations, institutions are more involved in MOOCs than in the US. That the number of European institutions in MOOCs is increasing, while in the US is decreasing. And MOOCs are perceived as a sustainable method for offering courses in Europe. They have an increasing positive attitude. They have a positive experience meeting some of the objectives of institutions. And the most dominant objective is to increase institutional visibility and using MOOCs for reputation aspects. Well, in the US, it's primarily related to reach new students, to recruit students. In Europe, it's seen as to have a new target group, so to reach new students and flexible learning opportunities. Let me state that all the commercial activities are centralized in the United States. So you even see that the number of MOOCs in the US platforms, the majority are now or almost now from Europe. The largest increase on the MOOCs on the US platforms like Coursera, edX, Udacity is provided by European institutions. So if Europe is embracing MOOCs and the hype is over in the United States, why are we giving our intellectual aspects, all our courses, to the United States providers? There is no big MOOC provider in Europe. We have small MOOC providers, iVersity in Germany, Open MOOC in Spain. In the UK you have FutureLearn. So they are language based. And most of our efforts, putting our intellectual aspects, our courses, are going to the United States. Strange. Something to think about.